As long as you can actually stay in the room. Sorry, I forgot to mention.
Like, I don't know. Diego, run it. Run, Diego.
Come on, hide.
Where are we going?
What happened?
I don't know. I'm just running. I heard you coming back.
Wait,
that shit.
That's not mine.
Hey,
Helen! Hey,
baby!
I'm gonna
bite you,
nigga!
Bro! Oh, nah,
oh, hell nah, he looking at me. I'm out of here.
到嘅。咁我有啲咪好似個葉咁樣，即係好似啲草啊啲葉咁樣出咗嚟啦。而家又開嚟好靚，紫色嘅。
근데 그 변기가 고장난 변기여서 그게 안 돼.
아니, 아니야. 그거 다 안 내려가는 거예요. 거기 그냥 그 진짜 오토바이.
Get on the local train, which doesn't leave that often. Stop food.
One of the foremost gardens in the world and was named a National Historic Landmark in 1967. Just up the hill on Side B, past the large rock outcropping, is the Rock Garden. It's home to an incredible selection of unusual flowers and plants from around the world that are grown in, around, and on rocks, including some of the smallest plants in the botanical garden. On Side A, you'll see a collection of pines and other cone-bearing plants. That's the Arthur and Janet Ross Conifer Arboretum. There are more than 1,000 pines, spruces, firs, and other conifers in this collection, including many venerable trees planted in the 1890s, right after the garden was established.
Beyond the conifers lies the Botanical Garden's crown jewel, the Enid A. Haupt Conservatory, completed in 1902. Inside, you can explore an acre under glass, a journey that takes you from tropical rainforest habitats to dry deserts. Filled with thousands of plants, it is an absolute wonder and the anchor for the garden's exhibition program.
Ahead, at the top of the hill, is the Lewester T. Mertz Library Building, completed in 1901. In front is the Lillian Goldman Fountain of Life, which was inspired by the Baroque fountains of Rome.
The library is home to more than 11 million items. The oldest is a manuscript from 1190. We also have field notebooks from botanists who went to uncharted regions in search of rare and new species. It's the largest and most active botanical and horticultural library in the world. While scientists from across the globe come to do research here, the library is open to everyone. It's a great place to learn more about what you see here at the garden. The library's art gallery hosts several exhibitions each year, which explore the deep connections between gardening and the humanities. You can also visit the science exhibitions in this building to learn more about the work of our cutting-edge researchers.
Toward the main road, take a minute to appreciate the tulip tree allée.
Allée is French for a tree-lined walk.
These are tulip trees, named for the green and yellow springtime flowers that resemble tulips. This memorable planting was named a New York City landmark in 2009, along with the library building and Fountain of Life. According to garden lore, the tulip trees planted here came from a single mother tree, which is the largest tree in the Allée, and it's just one of the thousands of trees across the landscape that are older than the garden itself.
The rest of the tulip trees were planted in 1905 under the direction of the garden's founding director, botanist and taxonomist Nathaniel Lord Britton.
Britton and his wife, Elizabeth Knight Britton, herself a distinguished botanist, were leaders of the movement to create a grand botanical garden in New York City in the late 19th century. While on their honeymoon in London in 1888, they visited the Royal Botanic Gardens, Kew. What they saw inspired them to lobby elected officials and civic leaders to create a public garden dedicated to science, education, and horticulture in New York.
They were successful, and in 1891, the New York State Legislature incorporated the New York Botanical Garden. Soon after, the couple selected this site, which featured a 50-acre old-growth forest surrounded by fields and pastures. In 1895, landscape architect Calvert Fox, co-designer of Manhattan Central Park, created a master plan for the garden to allow for the planting of beautiful and diverse collections while preserving the natural beauty of the landscape.
More than 125 years after its founding, the garden staff remained dedicated to preserving the natural and horticultural beauty of the landscape. They care for thousands of mature trees, plant hundreds of thousands of bulbs, annuals, and perennials, mow 75 acres of turf, and clip a mile of hedges to maintain this green oasis in the middle of New York City.
It is also a center for research and home to scientists and graduate students who are working to understand plant diversity and save the plants of the world. As they travel the globe, they might be collaborating with local partners in Brazil to preserve the rainforest, or recording the medicinal uses of plants in the South Pacific. Hudson Valley and Central Park. NYBG scientists have written hundreds of books, from field references to a handbook of poisonous plants used in hospital emergency rooms.
Our scientists work in the Garden's Pfizer Plant Research Laboratory and the William and Linda Steer Herbarium. The Steer Herbarium is the second largest herbarium in the world. It houses approximately 8 million dried, pressed plant specimens, including some dating to the 1700s, which are used by scientists to identify new species and document where plants grow. A, this area is called Twin Lakes. A century ago, people used to flock here to swim in summer and ice skate in winter. Today, birds flock here, especially water birds and seasonally migrating species. On Saturday mornings, you can join free bird watching tours. Garden visitors have spotted more than 200 species.
To cross the Bronx River, originating in Westchester County and extending 23 miles to the East River, it is the city's only freshwater river. Once lined with factories and mills, it became very polluted. Now, thanks to the efforts of conservation organizations, the river is cleaner than it has been in centuries, and is once again home to a wonderful array of wildlife, from beavers to American eels.
Stream from here, the Bronx River cuts a dramatic gorge through the 50-acre Thane Family Forest, the largest surviving stand of uncut first-growth forest in New York City. Since its founding, the garden has preserved the forest in its natural state, but over the centuries it has suffered from the impacts of human activity and invasive non-native species. To ensure the forest remains healthy, the garden has implemented a program of ecological restoration.
Watching our next stop, in the Magnolia Collection. This is one of the oldest plant collections in the garden. The first trees were planted here in the early 1900s. When they flower in early spring, the magnolias create an unforgettable spectacle. The Magnolia Collection is just one of many tree collections in the garden. More than 30,000 trees, ranging from centuries-old titans to newly planted saplings, grow across the landscape. We're now passing through the oak collection, which includes oaks from Europe, Asia, and North America. Oaks are among the most economically and ecologically important trees in the world. The wood is used to build fine furniture and wine casks. Deer, chipmunks, rabbits, squirrels, and many other mammals feast on the acorns. The leaves are an important source of food for the caterpillars and other insects that, in turn, are consumed by the many birds found in the garden.
The living plant collections serve the garden's mission as a museum of plants. Scientists and students use these collections to learn about the diversity and adaptability of the plant kingdom. can visit throughout the year and observe how different species and cultivated varieties change with the seasons. Our curators constantly evaluate the collections and search out interesting new varieties to add.
Just about to pass the green zone at the top of the hill on Side A. That's the home of the Green Materials Recycling Center. Funded by generous public and private donors, it's where we compost all the leaves, grass clippings, spent flowers, and other material generated as we care for the garden. We use the compost we create to improve our soil and feed our plants, which helps to reduce the amount of chemical fertilizers needed to help our plants thrive. On the same hill on Side A is the East Gate. This area, which is made accessible by the Ann Hubbard Bridge, was completely redesigned in 2017. It now provides improved daytime access to the garden for our neighbors and visitors who arrive there by subway.
Up to our next stop, the Edible Academy. This unique place was completed in 2018 and brings together the Ruth Ray Howell Family Garden, which has been located on this site for more than 30 years, with new year-round facilities that offer life-changing programs for local children and their families. It's a place where kids can dig in the soil, play with worms, learn what it takes to make a garden thrive, and maybe even want to eat their vegetables. Cooking demonstrations offer plenty of nutritious fun for adults and kids alike. The New York Botanical Garden occupies was once owned by the family of Pierre Lorillard, who made his fortune in the tobacco industry. Several historic buildings from the Lorillard estate remain today, including the large stone stable on Side A and the nearby gatehouse, as well as the stone mill.
On Side B is the cherry collection. Be sure to visit in early April when the trees transform the valley with fluffy clouds of pink and white.
On the other side of the road is the Byrne family lilac collection, which was completely restored in 2016. In late April, this whole area becomes a sea of color, from white and pale blue to lavender and deep dark purple, and the fragrance is incredible.
Just past the lilac collection is the award-winning Peggy Rockefeller Rose Garden.
Hop off here and you can wander through the nearly 4,000 from heirloom varieties cherished by French Empress Josephine to modern selections chosen for their beauty, fragrance, and disease resistance. The roses begin flowering in late May, peaking in June and September. In some years, we have even had roses blooming in early December. Was designed in 1916 by pioneering landscape architect Beatrix Ferrand, a leader in her profession in the early 20th century. Ferrand's vision for the site wasn't fully realized until 1988, when David Rockefeller helped NYBG complete this garden in honor of his wife, Peggy, who loved roses. Ahead is the Adam R. Rose and Peter R. McQuillan Horticulture Operations Center, the headquarters for the horticulture staff who care for the garden's trees and historic landscape.
We are going to stop on the bridge up ahead, overlooking another scenic section of the Bronx River. As we approach the stop, you can't miss the Lillian and Amy Goldman stone mill on Side B. The Lorillard family once used this mill to create snuff, a popular alternative to smoking tobacco. Yes, the stuff that made people sneeze. Built in 1840, it is a National Historic Landmark and a New York City landmark. If you follow the path past the stone mill, 1840, a tall bridge that was featured in the opening credits of the New York-based classic, Sesame Street. At the end of the path, you will see the waterfall that helped to provide power to the Laurel Arts Mill. The arrival of European settlers, the Bronx River provided food and water for the Lenape people. Later, the river became a vital economic resource for colonial Americans, and by the mid-1700s, its steady flow was furnishing hydropower to 12 mills. In the late 1700s, the Laurel Arts dammed the river to provide water power for the stone mill. Today, you'll see a grassy triangle with an enormous black moat. It's almost 200 years old.
Turn, look up the road for the grove of small trees on the slope on Side A. This is the Donald J. Bruckman Crabapple Collection. The crabapples in this collection and throughout the grounds flower in spring, usually in late April. And just beyond the crabapples is Daffodil Hill.
Here we are at the stop, a perfect place to take a walk through the Thane family forest, get a better look at the daffodils in early spring, or begin a stroll through the azalea garden.
While driving along the Thane family forest, even a short walk along its paths will show firsthand how enchanting the garden's old-growth forest can be. It's like stepping back in time. The forest offers some of the best chances to see members of our resident wildlife: owls, beavers, mink, and deer.
The garden on Side A, completed in 2011, spreads across 11 shaded acres and features thousands of azaleas and rhododendrons and woodland perennials. When the azaleas flower in early May, the entire hillside is transformed into a pointless canvas of pinks, purples, and whites. Even when the azaleas aren't in flower, the azalea garden is a great place for a walk. Mature tulip trees, oaks, and sweet gums cast welcome shade in summer that cools the masses of ferns, hostas, and other shade-loving plants that line the paths. Spectacle reaches its pinnacle in late October. In winter, look out for fragrant witch hazels and clusters of snowdrops and crocus. One of the year-round highlights is the 155-foot tulip tree in the center of the azalea garden. It's the New York Botanical Garden's tallest tree. You will see a path just beyond more rock outcroppings. That's the Mitsubishi Wild Wetland Trail. It leads you along a swamp full of trees, shrubs, and grasses that flourish in cool, wet ground and provide a welcoming habitat for frogs, turtles, and songbirds. On Side B is the Native Plant Garden, a gift of the Leon Levy Foundation in 2013. On Side A is the colorful entrance to the Everett Children's Adventure Garden. Hands-on activities and experiments for kids of all ages add another level of fun to discovering, exploring, and experiencing nature.
Back at the Leon Levy Visitor Center. Here you can find information about the garden programs and events, stop for refreshments, and visit the NYBG shop. If you haven't yet visited the Enid A. Haupt Conservatory, it's just a short walk from here. Plant Garden members, thank you for your support. We love it when you visit. If you're not a member, join today. We can credit a portion of today's ticket toward a membership. See any ticket window for more details.